So, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our latest Earth Talk. This is the third week in our course called Mind in Nature, which is both an elective for the MA in Holistic Science, MSc in Holistic Science, and the MA in Economics Transition, and also open to the public. It's our last week, and our teacher this week is David Rothenberg, about whom one can say an awful lot. He's a remarkable person, as you're about to find out. He's a full professor. At New Jersey Institute of Technology. He's a philosopher. I mean, when he was in your 20s, I think, worked with Arne Næss, the great Norwegian philosopher who founded the etiology approach. And he's written many books. More recently, he's been working on sounds in nature. And he's written, the latest book is Survival of the Beautiful, about aesthetics in nature. Then, before that, Why Birds Sing. Before that, a book on whale song, several other books. He's a prolific writer, a prolific singer, brilliant musician, a clarinetist. So, welcome, David. Thank you for coming back to the college. And prepare yourselves for a stellar evening.
Thanks so much. It's great to be here. So this is the first time I've actually been teaching at the college. Even though after I graduated college myself, I went to work for the Ecologist magazine in Cornwall. There I met Satish, who was working for Resurgence, even way back then. We already had the dream of starting a college one day. So since before the college existed, I always wanted to come teach here. So I see so many people here, and I think I see some people who has not been coming to my course, which means I can repeat my bird song slowed down examples and everyone won't get bored. Because people like to know a little bit about what's going on, the idea of making music out of nature. And I spent some time making music with bird sounds, with whale sounds and insect sounds, and also playing live with whales, broadcasting my clarinet underwater, and playing live with insects being covered by cicadas, and playing along with them, and with birds as well. So not only just taking their sounds, but doing it live. Here we kind of are taking the sounds, because we haven't invited too many other species in yet. Haven't arrived. At least we don't know. Maybe there's some on you disguise. So when I began my class the other day, I talked about how bird songs often sound so musical to people, but love the sounds could go by too fast. Here's a wood thrush, an American bird. Very common bird, you hear this. Locations like this, and you might hear, oh, this sounds like sounds you might hear outside here being sung by blackbirds or robins or who knows what, then, are there some basic sonic principles that all birds share, that maybe all life forms share? We kind of miss this sound sometimes, but if you slow it down, bring the pitch down, it gets in the realm of human music, and the very same song slowed down is this. Sing that the musicality in these bird songs is really important. really part of the sound. It's not just some notes. It doesn't just sound like music to us when you slow it down. It really is music. Birds need to sing these songs. They all have the same function, if you care about the function of music. These male birds are singing to defend territories and attract mates, but the way they do it is vastly different from species to species, for no other reason beyond the fact that the females turned out to have liked these particular kinds of songs over the generations, and they determine the aesthetics of each species. They decide they like this kind of thing over millions of years. And there's no practical objective reason for all this difference. It's just a possibility. There's a possibility for aesthetics and beauty to matter in evolution and the traits of different animals. And in my book, Survival of the Beautiful, I write about how Darwin was totally aware of this. He wrote that birds have natural aesthetic sense. They appreciate beauty. And since then, you know, scientists tend to avoid these topics. They think it's hard to test them. But as a musician, by taking the aesthetics of bird sound seriously, you can find a way into what the birds are really up to. Take the hermit thrush, even more complicated. Similar kind of bird. Musical ideas, and as a human musician, you can make your music more than human, as my friend David Aper might say. You enter into the musical, cultural world of other species by taking their music seriously. Every species has a different amount or different kinds of senses of beauty that it's interested in. Some don't care so much, but others can get very extremely specific, interested in all kinds of sounds that can get interesting to us. The next piece is based on the sounds of the thrush nightingale, the kind of nightingale you hear in Eastern Europe. That sounds, it sounds very different than I thought nightingales would sound like, having read Shakespeare and Keats and these kinds of things. In America, we don't have nightingales. I thought they were very melodic and kind of mellifluous and hermit thrush-like, but actually they sound more like a DJ scratching records. It's good electronic music. So finally, in our world today, in technology, we may be able to appreciate the music of the nightingale much more directly than previous generations. I don't know. You can tell me. Thank you. sense, but you know, the aesthetics of birds can be very different than humans. And nowhere is it more clear than probably the bird with the most complicated of any songs in the world. A song so complex it takes him 6 years to learn to sing. And this is the song of the Albert's lyrebird in Australia. The lyrebird is, everything about it is strange. And it's no secret that Australia and New Guinea have some of the strangest creatures that have evolved anywhere. Probably because they don't have, I'm not speaking of human creatures here, and probably because they never had traditionally, millions of years ago, predators to prevent extreme behavior, extremely risky behavior from evolving. So take, for example, the Albert's lyrebird, who during mating season, the male Albert's lyrebird stands in one place for weeks just doing this performance, and he finds a place that he likes where a branch has fallen down, and where vines come down, they move up and go into the trees, so that when he does his dance, it comes at the end of his song, it shakes the trees for maximum effect. So he's always just standing there. If there are any predators, they know exactly where to find him. So Albert's lyrebirds mate in the winter, when no other birds are singing. So you hear a bird song that time of year, you know it's an Albert's lyrebird. However, the Albert's lyrebird performs a song composed out of little fragments of the bird songs of every other bird that might be singing it at the spring time of the year. It's as if he's trying to set the mood for springtime, and it's not actually springtime. And he picks the noisiest, scratchiest, strangest sounds made by other birds. But very odd, noisy sounds. Even if a bird has a very beautiful sound and then ends with a lyrebird will pick that. He also imitates with his beak the sound of fluttering wings. So instead of fluffing his wings, he'll go. Fluffing wings. Here it sounds like he's moving his wings. He's not. He's making the sound effect. He's a master of, and it's not just imitating. He has a whole composition he puts together out of all these sounds. And it has a form. It begins with a territorial call designed to be heard by other males that goes whoop, 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 whoop. Very noticeable. You hear that a few times. This is like a music class. You can hear the territorial call in the beginning and then in the middle. Then you hear the cavalcade of imitations of other bird sounds put together in a very kind of logical way. It's always, you know, has to make some sense to it. Those of you who know all these birds will recognize them. You'll hear kookaburras. Wow. You'll hear a little bit of that. And other specific birds that Australian birds will know. Then, right towards the end, he switches to this other mode. He flips his feathers over his head. He starts to shake these trees by just jumping around. And he makes a sound like a radio tuning into outer space, called grovelly by the experts. These are not like what you would think a beautiful bird song is, but it's a complicated bird song. And then when he's done singing this, he will start again. Take a break to eat in the middle of the day, come back, and start again. And you know, female lyrebirds lay one egg every 2 years. And mostly, these birds just sing and sing and sing. It's very rare to ever see them mating. And it's very rare they actually get to mate, I think. And so one of the ornithologists studying this, trying to understand this behavior, said, well, I reckon it's all just sheer frustration, really. So, you can be the judge as you hear the sound of the... Now, if you remember from the lesson here, territorial call, section of imitations, territorial call comes back, more imitations, and then grouking towards the end, building to this whole climax. So, and I went to play live with these birds up in the forest to see if I could understand. So I'm simulating that here.
Thank you.
The most famous song, it was the song of the humpback whale, which we're going to hear soon enough. But first, I thought I'd play you a piece that's based on the sounds of orcas, or otherwise known as killer whales. They are known as killer whales because they kill a lot of stuff, not people. And they're the first whale species in which culture was really identified. They're the same genetically identical whales live in different ways in the same place. So, for example, off Vancouver Island, there are resident whales that mostly eat fish. And there are transient whales that come through that eat mammals. They will eat seals, they will eat deer, they'll even eat moose if they can catch one swimming. Not people. And so the mammal-eating transient killer whales, they have all different sounds. They're kind of quieter. And I thought they were sort of more scary. So you can hear their sound here.
Great time, get drunk, make love, swim. just see how people treat the dead. Somebody's using you like that. Back into the mouths of the ones who tell them. Truth is a little child. You see, deep inside me, there's still no place where people don't die. I'm gonna bring back everybody, put them back in this world like the sun. You're like a drifting log with rusting nails in it. You are the sun. Thank you.
Fortunately for them, most of they heard whales. And they were a bit disappointed by this. But there was one sonar operator named Frank Watlington who said, oh, these songs have to get out. People have to hear them. So he gave them to Roger Payne and Scott McVeigh, some young scientists, and they said, before we figure this out, let's just release it to the world. And they released this record, Songs of the Humpback Whale, which is the best-selling nature recording of all time. If you're interested in that. It's a multi-platinum album. Maybe some of you had it. And it introduced these songs to the world in 1970. And the world has never been the same since. Nobody cared about saving the whales until hearing these songs. And that's what got people interested in caring about these animals. And in the science paper written by Payne and McVeigh, they very, very importantly wrote a rare sort of line in a science paper. Those of you scientists here, I appreciate that they said, the humpback whale emits a series of surprisingly beautiful sounds. And you're going to hear them now. I can tell you a little bit about this song. It might seem like a bunch of strange foreign noises to start, but actually it's a structured song with rhythm, with different phrases that repeat, with one theme, then another. And it might be so slow that it's hard to hear, but you can, once you get beyond the strangeness or the power of each individual sound, you hear something much different than the killer whales that are repeating the same thing. Again, the humpback whale has a long song, the whole structure. So it immediately inspires a kind of music. Only the males make this song, and they sing, they're constantly changing it as a group. They're all singing the same song, but they gradually evolve it together into something new. Why, you might ask, do they change it if they all want to sound the same? I don't know. Nobody knows. Because all the males are doing it during mating season, the standard explanation is this song is sung to attract the attention of female whales. In 40 years, people have been watching them, trying to figure out what they're doing. They've never seen a female whale show any interest in this. Maybe about something else entirely. He loves this song.
Yeah.
creature, and they make a sound sort of like millions of them. When you hear millions of them doing that, you start to hear sort of fills the sky with a thrum. And I played some live concerts with them. Actually brought them on stage. I don't know if it was the right time here. We have them right here, and they behave pretty well. And we put them on the microphone and just sing. So no cicadas were harmed in this concert, which I recorded pieces of it here, so you hear the actual cicadas being transformed. And some of them were just flooding around on the microphones, a concert we did a few years ago in Illinois. If you come to America, end of May, beginning of June in New York and in the Hudson Valley, we're going to be doing many concerts, hopefully with as many live cicadas as we can get talk into being part of the show. So something like this. come to America, end of May, beginning of June, to experience this phenomenon, because otherwise you have to wait 17 years.
may I ask, is that the original speed of the song?
You heard them all changed. You heard some of the original speed.
All right.
Different parts. You heard occasional whoops, and then it was transformed, and at the end you heard what it actually sounds like when they're all in the distance. Because if you take so many of them together, millions of them, the end disappears. It's kind of, it just surrounds you.
Are there these, particularly whales and birds, are they singing to communicate? Or what's your human interpretation of?
Well, they're, the singing of those animals, when the males are doing a lot of these performances, they're trying to defend their territories and attract mates, but that doesn't really explain why they've evolved such elaborate behavior, unless you look at it that in the mind of female creatures that are interested in this, they select for over the years, for this kind of thing. And this is what Darwin wrote about in The Descent of Man, when he got so interested in beauty and nature. Sexual selection works differently than natural selection, which is survival of the fittest and what's useful and practical. These are impractical, wild, crazy things that nature can evolve. And, there's just so many things that there are that's just hard to explain. Like, how did this manage to happen? Like, this next piece, almost the last one, maybe. But the, mostly, the bigger the animal, the louder the sound. Not in the case, cicadas are pretty loud. Whales are really, really loud. And generally, small animals can't make as much noise. But if you make a graph of, let's start from here, going up, how big the animal is, how loud it sounds. Cicadas are like up here. And then otherwise, little small creatures and mice and bats.
Whales are like Pavarotti.
Whales are really big and they're really, really loud. But there's one animal. If you have a graph like this, there's one bloop on the graph. There is one insect, a tiny water beetle that lives in Britain, that makes a sound almost as loud as a whale. And it's called the lesser water boatman. Absolutely, but underwater. And they, I'm sorry to report that they make this sound by waving their penis underwater. You can't make this stuff up. This is a widely reported story, as you might imagine, and it's not to give you any idea of some things to practice at home. But this sound, actually this piece uses... it basically takes this sound and sort of transforms it around the very idea of the lesser water boatman's loudest penis, like this insane thing they should have done. Again, nobody knew about this until they dropped a microphone under water and thought something was wrong with it. So much noise was coming out. And pretty scary. There you go. So an insect project, which nobody has heard, I have one or two copies of this CD that comes out next month. There's some very strange sounds, including this one. And basically, it's just very small insects can make some sounds you just really don't expect.
Thank you. Down off
Bermuda, a quarter mile down. I took out my recorder, let the tape spin around. It was the musical scene and the passionate wail that came from the heart of the world's last whale. I didn't just hear grunting, I didn't just hear squeaks, I didn't just hear bellows, I didn't just hear shrieks. It was the musical scene and the passionate wail that came from the heart of the world's last whale. Now down in the Antarctic, the harpoons wait, but it's up on land the people decide my fate. In Tokyo town, they'll be telling the tale. If it's life or death for the world's last whale. So here's a little test to see how you feel. Here's a little test for this age of the automobile. If we can save our singers in the sea, maybe there's a chance to save you and me. I heard the song of the world's last whale as I rocked in the moonlight and sailed. It could happen to you also without fail, like it happened to me, sang the world's last whale.